فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين صلوا على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد لتعجيل فرج الإمام صاحب العصر والزمان صلوا على محمد وآل محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد الفاتحة بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم صلى الله عليك يا مولاي يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين الأبرار الميامين المظلومين المضطهدين السلام عليك يا مولاي وابن مولاي يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا غريب يا مظلوم يا عطشان كربلاء ما خاب والله من تمسك بكم وأمن من لجأ والتجأ إليكم يا ليتنا فيا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز والله فوزا عظيما بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وآمنوا بما أنزلت مصدقا لما معكم ولا تكونوا أول كافر به ولا تشتروا بآياتي ثمنا قليلا وإياي فاتقون ولا تلبسوا الحق بالباطل وتكتموا الحق وأنتم تعلمون وأقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة واركعوا مع الراكعين آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم والسلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. My dear brothers and sisters, I repeat this same three verses of the Holy Quran every night, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He reminds the people of the book that believe in what I sent down, i.e. the Quran in this case, because it testifies to the truth of the other messages. Allah's message was continuous and it was perpetual. What does that mean? That when Nabi Adam alayhi salam was on earth, humanity came and they were together, and eventually as humanity grew, people multiplied, they reproduced, they spread through the earth. After many thousands of years, Nabi Allah Nuh alayhi salam, he came. Nuh alayhi salam, not only was he a Nabi, not only was he a Rasul, not only was he Ulul Azm, one with great resolve as the Quran describes, but he was Sahib al-Sharia. Sahib al-Sharia means he came with a law and established the first law of Allah on earth at that point. That is the Sharia of Nuh. Now, after Nuh's time, every prophet who came followed the Sharia of Nuh alayhi salam. They didn't come with a new Sharia, a new law. They followed the law of Nuh alayhi salam until the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, Khalilullah. Khalilullah, he came, and when he came, again, he is a Nabi, he is a Rasul, he is Khalilullah, the friend of Allah, and he is Sahib al-Sharia. He brings with him a new Sharia, new in the sense that now what law he brings with him becomes established on earth, and the previous law that was there, the law of Nuh alayhi salam, is removed, essentially. So now the law of Ibrahim. Now for Ibrahim alayhi salam's sons, for Ishaq alayhi salam, for Ismail alayhi salam, and the progeny after that, who did they follow? The law of Ibrahim alayhi salam. This continues until you get to the time of Musa alayhi salam. Musa alayhi salam, same thing. He brings a law with him. Once he establishes that law, that Torah, and I've already told you that he goes to Tur Sina, he climbs the mountain, he brings the tablets, and law has been established. That law stays, and it stays in the time after him, in the time of Yusha ibn Nun, in the time of Ilyas, in the time of other Anbiya and Mursaleen, and continues. And today I will tell you two stories that followed in that time. And that law continues until the time of Isa alayhi salam. Isa alayhi salam now brings another law. That law abrogates the law of Musa alayhi salam. And Isa alayhi salam's law continues. And it continues on the earth until Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam appears. And now brings the final law. The law that Islam establishes. And the law of Allah that will remain for the rest of time. So you see that it is a perpetual motion in terms of humanity. And humanity at no time could say that Allah didn't tell us this or didn't tell us that. The haqq was always in front of them. That's why, in addition to constantly showing signs, Musa alayhi salam would constantly come and tell them what is the truth. You all know the story of when they find the young man dead. You know the story. Surah Al-Baqarah, when they say Surah Al-Baqarah, why is it called Surah Al-Baqarah? Because the man who was found dead, and the Bani Israel wanted to know who killed him, he was murdered. Allah sent a wahi to Musa alayhi salam and said, Ya Nabi Allah, tell them to bring a cow, and that to take basically a piece of that cow, and by that cow you will be able to tell who the killer is. Now, you know, what did the Bani Israel do? They started to give trouble. What is the color of the cow? What does the cow do? Is it young? Is it old? Does it pasture? What? They kept asking him. They kept asking him. They kept troubling him and kept troubling him. And wouldn't adhere and obey the command of Allah. Finally, they bring the cow. And you know this. It belonged to an orphan. And the orphan gives them the cow, and that is not the point of my story, but eventually the cow is taken, it is slaughtered. They take a piece of the cow, strike the dead body comes to life, and he says, I was murdered by my cousins because of jealousy. And so you see that Musa alayhi salam keeps giving sign after sign, sign after sign, sign after sign. Why? What is the purpose of it? Why does Rasul come and say, قُولُوا لَا إِلَهَا إِلَّا اللَّهُ تُفْلِحُ. Say, لَا إِلَهَا إِلَّا اللَّهُ, you will be in success. Listen to me, I will point you to the truth. Follow the Qur'an, follow my sunnah, live on my path. Why all of this convincing? Why so much convincing? Tell me. It's a strange thing, no? That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَوْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ لَهَدَاكُمْ جَمِيعًا, if Allah wanted to, He can guide you, all of you. Can He not? Allah can do anything. He can open your heart and drop the iman into your heart. You'll believe. You can go to sleep tonight, tomorrow morning you get up, that's it. You will have perfect belief, 100%. If Allah wants to do that, He can. But He didn't do that. He didn't. He said, I have put the fitrah inside of you, the nature of you to find me, but you got to do the work. You have to do it. And how are you going to do it? By finding the truth. By looking for the truth. By discerning truth from batil, from haq from batil. You must, and that's on you, given the signs I have produced for you, whether it is mu'jiza in the case of Musa alayhi salam, or mu'jiza as in the case of Isa alayhi salam, bringing the dead to life, bi-ithnillah, or the Holy Quran as what Rasulullah has brought. You must look at the truth. And on top of it, don't cover up the truth with batil once you know it. And you know the ayah, وَلَا تَلْبِسُ الْحَقَّ بِالْبَاطِلِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُ الْحَقَّ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. This is a very pointed statement in the Quran, that don't cover haqq or truth with batil, and do not hide the truth, and you know what it is. You are aware. So let me ask that when someone says to you, what is haqq? Right? The word haqq has been used in the Quran a lot. Ja' al-haq wa zahaq al-batil. Haq has come and batil has been removed, has been obliterated. What is haq? In English, when you translate haq, it is truth. Right? Haq is truth. But is that really what it is? How can you figure out what is truth? What does it mean to be truthful? Yes? If somebody comes and tells you something and says, the best shawarma in the city of Dearborn can be found at, I don't know, where is the best shawarma in Dearborn? Someone tell me. Lapita. There's a place called Habib, maybe. Mint. I don't know. I'm throwing names out there. I don't really know. I'm not allowed to eat shawarma outside because I'm married to a Lebanese woman who I have to eat her shawarma. That's it. No one else's shawarma. So if they come and say, look, this place such and such has the best shawarma, and you say, ooh, that's the truth, how do you know? What makes you verify that this is the truth? They'll say it's the truth, you've taken their word from it, but what verifies it? What will verify it? What will verify it is that I go eat it and I say, oh yeah, that's the best shawarma. And then someone else goes and eats it, and that's the best shawarma. And then another lady goes and she eats it, and that's the best shawarma. And then we get someone from Russia to come, and they go there, and they eat it, and that's the best shawarma. And we get someone from Sudan to come, and they eat it, and they say it's the best shawarma. And someone from North Pole, and someone from South America, and someone from Southeast Asia, and someone from Europe, all go there, they eat that shawarma, and they say, yes, there is no better shawarma than that. Is that truth? Why would you say it's truth? Because everybody, all different types of people, not just Lebanese, not just me, but people of every background went and had the shawarma and said, oh, this is indeed the best shawarma. Does that make it truth? Well, some say no. Let's say everyone ate it and they all said it's good. Everyone says this is the best. There's nobody who thinks it's not the best. Then you would have to admit that that's the best shawarma, right? If everyone is saying this is the best, then there's no argument. It's the best. But if one person disagrees, is it now the best? No, it's not the best anymore. If one person disagrees with it, it's not the best. Haqq, when you define what is haqq, haqq means everyone accepts it as the truth. And even if they don't accept it as the truth, doesn't mean it's not true. I give you a point. That when Musa alayhi salam went to Tur Sayna, and he said, "Qala Musa ya Qala Musa li akhihi Harun akhlifni fi qawmi waslih wa la tattabi' sabila al-mufsidin." He goes up, he says, "My brother Harun, be my khalifa." He went up and left. Do you think all of those Bani Israel, they accepted that he is khalifa? They didn't accept him as khalifa. Many did not accept Harun as khalifa. But does that mean just because they didn't accept him as khalifa that he stopped being khalifa? No, he's khalifa, whether you accept it or don't. Whether you accept the truth or don't accept it, a quality, a characteristic of truth is that it remains. It is the truth. You accept it or don't, it's a fact. It is what is there. Same thing. You want to believe there's oxygen in the air or not? It's there because you have to breathe it. The minute you take it away, you will know that it's the truth, because why? You'll suffocate. You won't be able to breathe. So one of the qualities of haqq, yes, you define it as truth, but the quality of haqq is that its verity is pervasive and continuous. You cannot change it. The other thing about truth is that innahu da'imun wa baqi. It is ever present and it does not deteriorate. That is truth, right? Now, my example of shawarma, that whatever this restaurant is the best shawarma, eventually it may close down, right? Once it closes down, can you say it's the best shawarma? No, because it's closed down. It's not there anymore. So now you cannot apply the label of truth to it. Anything that is haqq, that is truth, will last. Will always last, will never go. And that's why Allah, what does He say? ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ رَبُّكُمُ الْحَقِّ. Allah is haqq, isn't He? He says, your Lord is haqq. Why? Because does Allah disappear? Will Allah stop? وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ فَانٍ. Except for what? Everything decays except for وَجْهَ اللَّهِ. Everything goes except for Allah. Why? Because Allah is haqq. Haqq never disappears. It never dissipates. It never degrades. It never goes. Sometimes it gets covered. It gets covered by falseness, by evil, God forbid, but it never deteriorates. It doesn't mean it falls apart or that it breaks up. It is always there. And you see this, that the reason why it sometimes disappears, even though people know it's the truth, is because people always have ulterior motives. I said to you that why is it that Allah constantly sent prophets to prove something to you about the truth? Why do we need to have the truth proven to us? Why? Because they want us to accept it with depth. If I convince you of the truth of something, rather than force it on you, rather than compel you to accept it as the truth, will you accept it more or less? You will accept it more because you did it of your own conviction. You saw it to be everlasting, pervasive, and continuous, and never leaving. And that's why Allah says in the Holy Quran, كَانَ النَّاسُ أُمَّةً وَاحِدًا فَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ النَّبِيِّينَ مُبَشِّرِينَ وَمُنذِرِينَ وَأَنزَلَ مَعْهُمُ الْكِتَابَ بِالْحَقِّ لِيَحْكُمَ بَيْنَ النَّاسِ فِيمَا اخْتَلَفُوا فِيهِ. Allah says that all the people were one. I mentioned to you about Adam alayhi salam. In those days, there were maybe 100 people on earth, 1,000 people on earth. You think they all lived in different places? One living in North America, one in China, one in South Africa? No, there's 100 people on earth. They live together. It's the beginning of time, beginning of humanity. Eventually, they begin to spread. More and more people are born, more and more are reproducing. Now they start to spread. So Allah says, I sent the prophets, I sent the messengers. They brought good news. They brought a warning to these people. And they told the people that, look, I'm going to give you a book. There's a book. It's full of truth, and it's going to decide. Why? Because now people started arguing. And think about it. If you have 100 people who basically own the whole world, you think anyone will fight? Nobody will fight. You have a whole world for 100 people. Today, we have over 6 billion people on the earth. Are people fighting for the earth? Yeah, they are. They are fighting for the earth. They are fighting for its resources, fighting for the water, for clean water, fighting for energy, fighting for sun, fighting for clean air. We fight. We have disagreement with each other. Yet this is something that existed even in those days as the early humans spread. So they began to spread and they began to argue. Why? Because now this land that originally I'm the only one living here, now there's two or three more people and they want land too. And so they started to argue. And the ayah now, it says, وَمَا أَخْتَلَفَ فِيهِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ أُوتُوهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمُ الْعِلْمِ بَغْيًا بَيْنَهُمْ. These people who started arguing with each other about things already knew what is the truth. مِن بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَتْهُمْ الْعِلْمِ. After they had already received knowledge about what is the truth, then they started arguing. You know why? Because of rebelliousness. Because of baghi. Baghi means that I want to create trouble, so I'm going to fight with you about it. People knew what the truth was, but because of baghi, because of this rebelliousness inside of them, they started to argue with each other. They started to fight with each other, that we know what is the truth, but doesn't matter, we're going to fight. You see, this is the nature of insan. That insan, at every cost, despite knowing the truth, something inside him compels him to go against it, to go against the truth, to fight against the truth. Why? Because of personal choices. And it comes down to that. Why is the truth important, my dear brothers and sisters? Because truth allows you to make proper decisions. If I know, let's say that eating shawarma, let's change shawarma. Let's say that if I know for sure there is scientific evidence, and I'm not saying there is, let's say there is scientific evidence that eating kanafa will give me heart disease. Wal'ayadu billah, okay, of course. Eating kanafa gives me heart disease. I know this for sure. Science has proven it. The studies are showing it. It's happening to people. They're eating kanafa, they're getting heart disease. Khalas, one kanafa, two kanafa, after 5 years you have heart disease, you get sick. Okay? You know it. This is the truth. This is the truth in front of you. But you keep eating it. What's going to happen to you? You're going to get heart disease. And why? Because you went against the truth. Because of what is established as a fact in front of you, of an inevitability, of something that's going to happen. And if you don't eat it, you chose not to eat it. Why? Because you knew the truth. So it comes down to one thing, making decisions. The truth, why is that important to us? Why does Allah always point out haq, 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 haq in everything? Because it points to you how to make a decision. Decision on good, decision on bad, decision on everything in life. If I know something to be the truth, I should act in a way that fulfills that truth and gets me to it so I can benefit from it. Now let me give you some stories. Huh? They say that the Bani Israel, and we have been talking for a few nights now about Bani Israel, that Bani Israel, they had gathered in a valley. Okay, and in this valley, the mountains had surrounded it. They were living there, the tribes of Bani Israel. And when they were living there, there was a passageway through the mountains that came to their village. And unfortunately, there were some tyrannical tribes there called the Gog and the Magog. It is mentioned in the Quran, Al-Ya'juj wal-Ma'juj. They would come and they will attack them and tyrannize them and steal from them and persecute them. And so they prayed, the Prophet was there with them. They said, oh, Nabi Allah, one Prophet, they don't give his name, that help us, we need some help. And give us a leader who can save us. So they're being persecuted. This tribe is coming out of the mountains, burning their houses, stealing their cattle, taking their possession. And so they asked the Nabi there that, Ya Allah, save us. We need help. Tell Allah to send us a leader who will be a champion for us and protect us from the Gog and the Magog. So the Nabi prays and a man comes and the Nabi, he says, look, this is the guy who has been appointed for you to be the leader. They look at him, he's kind of simple looking, although he's very strong. And they say, look, this is not the guy we really thought we were going to get as a leader. Look, they ask Allah for truth. Yet when Allah sends the truth, they don't accept it. They look at him and they say, look, he doesn't have enough money. He doesn't have social status like us. We need somebody like us who's got social status, who's got money. And the ayah of the Holy Quran describes it. And the Nabi answers them. He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِصْطَفَاهُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَزَادَهُ بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْجِسْمِ. Allah has chosen you, chosen this man for you. And above, when he says istafahu alaykum, means he is better than you. He's chosen above you. You wanted someone like you with mal and banoon and this and that. Allah chose Dhulqarnain and he put him above you. Istafahu alaykum. And not only that, he zadahu bastatan fil ilmi wa jism. He has given him so much of knowledge and strength, vitality. When he says jism, it doesn't, maybe he was a big man, but strength, vitality. And so now, somewhat begrudgingly, they listen to him. They listen to Dhulqarnain, and when they listen to Dhulqarnain, they eventually say, look, we need help. And I mentioned Dhul-Qarnayn, it's Talut in this case. We need your help. So he says to them, look, the passageway between the mountains needs to be sealed. So they bring all the iron, they melt the iron, they place the iron in between the mountains with his help because he is so strong, and they seal it. They seal that passageway. Now, what would have happened if they didn't accept him? They would have said, no, this is not what we are. We asked Allah to send someone. We need someone like us, and they don't accept this leader that Allah has sent to them. They reject it. And they say no. Invariably, the Gog and the Magog will come and tyrannize them again. And not only tyrannize them again, but put pressure on them in such a way until maybe they perish because of the punishment of Allah, or finally their eyes open up to what is the truth, to what God has chosen. And that's the quality of Haqq. That again, they will come and go, they will perish, they will suffer, but Haqq will remain what Haqq is. Isn't it? Same goes for us. You don't think our lives are the same? We come, we go. Our children come, they go. Parents come, they go. The only thing that remains is the path of Allah. And that's what we have to teach our children and learn ourselves to begin with, is that Haqq is one thing and one thing only. It's not multiple things. That's why it is what? Sirat al-Mustaqim, right? There's not multiple roads. It's one road, one path going towards the truth that you cannot compromise, you cannot shake, you have to stay on it. And I said to you that it's all about choices, yeah? That if you know the truth, your choice is easy. If you know Allah is the truth, ذَلِكُمُ اللَّهُ رَبُّكُمُ الْحَقِّ فَمَاذَا بَعْدَ الْحَقِّ إِلَّا ضَلَالٍ. Allah is Haqq. And anything outside of Haqq is what? Misguidance. It's misguidance. And so if you know Allah is Haqq, why are you not praying on time? Why are you not doing your fasting the way you should? When the time comes to give your khums, you give your khums. When you become mustati', you go for hajj. When you have obligations, you fulfill them. Because you don't consider, the reason you don't is because you don't consider it to be truth. At least not in its entirety. Do you? If you see something to be truth, will you fulfill it? You will fulfill it. Believe me, you will fulfill it. The minute you don't, it's because you don't accept it to be completely true. At least not in your actions. Your heart may accept it, but your actions don't demonstrate that you accept it totally as truth. When you do accept it totally, 100% as truth, and you translate to that actions, do you know what you get? Al-Imam Abi Abdullah al-Hussein. You get what he did in Karbala. That's what you get. Total 100% acceptance of the truth and a desire to live that truth. Now why? Let me finish here. When we decide, and we want to decide on anything in life, anything at all in life, we have lots of forces affecting us, lots of things influencing us, and this applies to everything. One, I will decide, and the thing that will impact me most is my ideology in life. What is my ideology? And we talked about ideology on the second or third night. That am I deciding as a Muslim or as an American or as a Lebanese or as a Pakistani or as an Indian or Afghani or something else? What is the ideology? And if my decision has to be made and the ideologies are clashing, which ideology will win? That is a major issue today in our lives. That when we decide in our life, is the ideology Islamic ideology or is it American, Western, something other cultural ideology? We have to ensure that the ideology of our choices are Islamic. They have to be. I'm not talking about what food you eat or the color of your clothes or how you style your hair or any of these things or what color glasses you wear or what car you drive. No. These are things that are mubah. Whether you do or don't do, that's irrespective. I'm talking about the critical things of your life. Your worship, your dealing with each other, the way you earn your living, the career you pursue, all of it. must be with an Islamic ideology. And in an effort, I'll say this, to live as a good citizen in our country. A Muslim is always a good citizen, contributing to the good of his country, including our country here in America, or wherever it is we are living. The second thing is we have to ensure that when we are making any sort of decision, that we know the consequences of that decision. Why is haq always compromised? Because we don't look at the consequences. We only look at it physically, that if I decide to go to medical school, I'm going to get lots and lots of money. I'll be rich. I'll be a rich doctor one day. We see it physically. We don't think about the emotional consequences or the psychological consequences or even worse, the spiritual consequences. Particularly the things we look at on our phones and on the internet and on TV. They affect us, my dear brothers and sisters. And we think, oh, it's innocent, there's nothing there. But believe me, like Al-Imam Al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam says, that your heart initially is white, and if you commit a sin, you get a black dot on it. And if you keep sinning and you don't ask for astaghfar, that black dot gets bigger and bigger and bigger until it envelops the whole heart. And sometimes this happens and we don't even know. We don't even know that it happened. We're not even aware, and we keep going down further and further and further. So we have to look at the consequences of our actions. And that's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he would say, Allahumma ja'al awaqib umurina khayra. Allah, make the consequences of our actions and our affairs always to be good. Not just that I do the good, but that the consequence also turns out to be good. Number three, my dear brothers and sisters, when you make a decision in your life, is the decision you make for tomorrow, that tomorrow I'm going to have a kanafa for breakfast, the same as you saving money for your retirement? Are those two decisions the same? They're not the same. They're not even remotely the same. Why? Because eating a kanafa lasts for all of what, 30 seconds, 40 seconds, 50 seconds? That's how fast I eat my kanafa. 30 minutes, 40 minutes. Whereas if you're saving for your retirement, you're talking about years down the road. And potentially something that not only will benefit you, but if you die without using it, it goes to who? Your beneficiaries, to your children. Those two decisions are not the same. Now imagine that you're making decisions only for the hayat ad-dunya and not actually for the real retirement that is after the grave. We don't consider that our decisions, forget about short term and long term in this life, are very trivial compared to the long term that is after this life. Our decisions should be made with the akhirah in mind. That what am I doing for my akhirah? And that's why the Quran says, وَتَزَوَّدُوا. Make sure you pack your bags for that akhirah. Prepare yourself. That is the third thing. The fourth thing, my dear brothers and sisters, in terms of making a decision, is we should not allow any decision to be made out of fear, and never make a decision out of doubt. Fear and doubt destroy the stability of insan. They destroy you. That's why you see every decision made by Imam Hussein alayhi salam was made with certainty and courage. No decision was made waveringly. He made every decision knowing what he is doing. So when you make your decision in life, do so knowing what you are doing. Don't allow fear to control you. And if you are afraid, ask yourself, why are you afraid? Because maybe you think what you're doing is not correct. Maybe you're afraid of the consequences. Maybe you feel that what you thought was going to benefit you is not actually going to benefit you. Consider why you are feeling afraid. And if you feel doubt, even more so, never act on doubt. And that's why even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, whenever he felt there was a difficult decision to make, the companion would say, Rasulullah would go do salat. We will see him leave the company of his companions and go stand on the musalla and the mihrab and do his prayers. Why? Because in Allah, you will find the haqq and you will find the truth and you will be able to remove the doubt. The last thing, my dear brothers and sisters, in terms of decision making, that when we decide to do something, we have to not only consider it's good for ourselves, but good for others. A Muslim, a mu'min, never does something solely with the desire to do good for him or herself only. If you want to do good, invariably that good should spread. If you want to do something that is based on haqq and in the pursuit of haqq, it will not only apply to you, it will apply to everybody. It will reach everybody. So when you decide on what am I going to do, not only for me, but for others as well. Today we live in a world that is way too individualistic. This world that we live in, it thinks only about itself. We talk about career, we talk about pursuing our goals. It's good. It's good to go to college and get a degree and do well and to pursue being a doctor. As a man or a woman, you want to pursue those things. But should we not sit down and ask that in doing so, I've benefited myself, but what have I done for somebody else? What good have I done for anybody? That is how our decisions should be made, in an altruistic manner, in a manner that serves humanity. Because that is the way of Ahlul Bayt, alayhimus salatu wassalam. That they gave and they gave and they gave and they gave, and their choices were always for the ummah. What you see in Karbala, Imam Ali alayhi salatu wassalam, you know that. That when he says, Ibn Abi Quhafa knew my position, that it was the mihwar, that it was the access point. And he knew, and it was poking me in my eye with such pain and severity, the circumstances that surrounded me. And I had the option either to speak up and raise a hand or to remain silent and be patient. And I chose to remain silent and be patient. Why? For greater good. For greater good. So much so that when the Khawarij, when he was dying, you know this, when Imam Ali alayhi salatu wasalam was lying on his deathbed and the people were surrounding him, he told them that don't fight the Khawarij anymore. After my death, you are not to fight them. They said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, why? Why are we not to fight them? They are the ones who essentially have led to your death. They are the ones who have been a thorn in your side and given you difficulty upon difficulty upon difficulty. You know what his answer was? He said, because maybe there are going to be true mu'min in their children, in their descendants. We don't know that. We act summarily thinking that, well, this is a personal matter to me and it affects no one. No, my dear brothers and sisters, there's no such thing as this is a personal matter to me. And understand my meaning. Obviously, everyone has personal matters in their lives. But when it comes to haqq, there's no such thing as personal matter. Our service to Allah means we serve humanity. Our doing good for ourselves means doing good to others. And that is the legacy of Anbiya and Mursaleen. And that is the legacy of Al-Imam Al-Husayn. His struggle, his fight, his giving everything in the cause of God was why? So we can be sitting here today. So that there are people in India, Brahmin Hindus, who celebrate the name of Al-Husayn. These are not even Muslims. Who celebrate the name of Al-Husayn. They are called Husayni Brahmin. Why? Because he was a champion of goodness for all humanity. That's why Charles Darwin, and you have Mahatma Gandhi's quotation over here. Because you see a human being whose decision impacts everybody. Good for everybody. Benefit for everybody. We have to think this way. Not with delusions of grandeur. Not to think that we are some saint sent by God. But to think that the consequences of our actions should reach beyond us in terms of goodness. And you see that Imam Hussein demonstrated this not only by giving his own life, but by giving the life of those near him and the ones dearest to him. And even those who in the prime of their life, any one of us, if we were in Imam Hussein's position, I don't know we would be ready to give in the way he did. Because when it comes time to do so, it is not easy. And now Al-Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salam, you know this, is departing from Medina and leaving. And he has already decided, and the bags are packed, and the caravans are loaded up, and they are ready to leave. And suddenly, the ladies of the Bani Hashim, they come. And they say, Yabna Rasulillah, you want to leave, and we know you are adamant about doing so. And you are going to depart the city of your grandfather. We ask you just to fulfill one request for us. He says to them, what is that request? They say, Yabna Rasulillah, leave for us Ali ibn al-Akbar over here. Don't take him. Let him stay here with us. Have mercy on our weakness and our tender hearts, Yabna Rasulillah. He said, why? They said, Yabna Rasulillah, because any time we longed for the face of our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, any time we missed looking at your grandfather Rasulullah, we would look at the face of Shabih al-Rasul, Ali ibn al-Akbar. We will look at him and we will feel peace in our hearts. Imam Hussein, he calmly and gently reassures them, but says to them that his path is with mine. He must follow with me, because there is a purpose that Allah has chosen for him. And that when they get to Karbala on the 2nd of Muharram, and the man tells Imam Hussein, what is the name of this place? And Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he says, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. And Ali ibn al-Akbar hears his father say, Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un, and I seek refuge in Allah from the difficulties and the trials that are approaching us. Ali ibn al-Akbar, he says, Ya Aba, alasna ala al-haq? Are we not on the truth, my father? His father looks at him, he says, Bala ya bunay, we are on the truth. My son, we are on the truth. Ali ibn al-Akbar. He says, Idhan ya Aba, la nubali an namut, wa nahnu ala al-haq. My father, we are not afraid, we are not afraid to be killed, and we are on the path of truth. Ya Allah, ya Aba Abdullah. Ali ibn al-Akbar on the day of Ashura, the enemy soldiers had killed the companions of Al-Imam Al-Hussein. The youth of Bani Hashim had gathered, and one by one they were saying to each other, we must defend our uncle, our father Al-Hussein. Ali ibn al-Akbar came forward. He came to his father and he said, Ya Aba, is it time for me to go to the battlefield? Imam Hussein, he says, my son, I wish you had a son like yourself, so you would know what a father feels like when he sends his son out to battle, knowing that there is no return. Ali ibn al-Akbar is told to go back to the tents, bid farewell to the ladies. And with what face is he going to come to Al-Hawra Zainab al-Kubra and go to the tents of Umm Kulthum and go to the tent of his mother Layla? After bidding farewell, he starts to walk. Suddenly, someone starts to pull on his shirt. He turns around and sees his sister, Sukaina bint al-Husayn. She says, my brother, Ya Ali, are you going out to the battlefield where the companions of our father went and have not returned? Ali ibn al-Akbar bent down, hugged Sukaina bint al-Husayn, reassured her, told her to go back to the tent. They say he went out to the battlefield after Imam Hussein prepared him with the armor, prepared his sword, and got him onto the horse to attack the enemy and defend the Haram of Rasulullah. They say that Imam Hussein, he raised his hands and he says, Allahumma ashhad ala haula al-qawm فَإِنَّهُ بَرَزَ إِلَيْهِمْ شَابٌ أَشْبَهَ النَّاسِ خَلْقًا وَخُلُقًا وَمَنْطِقًا بِنَبِيِّكَ مُحَمَّدٍ. My Allah, bear witness that these enemy soldiers are facing down a youth who in his qualities and characteristics and appearance is closest in resemblance to your Prophet Muhammad. And if ever, Ya Allah, we longed to see the face of your Rasul, we would look at the face of Ali al-Akbar. They say Ali al-Akbar goes to the battlefield and starts to fight the enemy soldiers. They say maybe that Layla, the mother, is watching from the tents. Ali al-Akbar, he comes upon one of the champions of the soldiers of Umar ibn Sa'ad. His name is Bikr ibn Ghanim. Bikr ibn Ghanim faces Ali al-Akbar. They say that when Layla sees her son facing this champion, she raises her hands to the sky and she says, Ya Rad Yusuf ala Yaqub, Ya Rad Musa ila ummihi, Rud alayya waladi Ali. Oh, the one who brought Yusuf back to Yaqub. Oh, Ya Allah, you brought Musa back to his mother. Bring back for me my son Ali ibn al-Akbar. Ali ibn al-Akbar fights that champion Bikr ibn Ghanim. He defeats him, but he sustains many injuries fighting the soldiers. He comes back to his father after a reprieve. He says, Ya Abba, Al-Atash qad qatalani wa thiql al-hadid ajhadani. My father, the thirst has killed me. My father, the weight of the armor on my back is wearing me and tiring me down. هل من شربة ماء من سبيل أتقوى بها على الأعداء. Is there some drop of water, my father, that I can drink? One little taste of water, just so that I can regain my strength and go back to the battlefield and fight the enemy soldiers. Imam Hussein heard this. He began to weep and cry. He says, Ya Bunay Qatil Qalila, Ma Aqraba An Talqa Jaddaka Rasulallah, Fayusqika Bi Ka'sihi Al-Awfa, Sharbatan La Tadhma Ba'daha Abada. Go, my son, fight just a little bit longer. Rasulallah, your grandfather will be waiting for you very soon. You will meet him. He will give you a drink of water. That thirst will be quenched such that it'll never come back. Ali ibn al-Akbar turns the reins of the horse and charges the battlefield. Now fighting the enemy soldiers, attacking them from one side. This is no ordinary youth. Umar ibn Sa'd sees him coming. He calls his soldiers. He screams at the loudest voice. He says, this is no ordinary young man. This is the son of Al-Hussein. This is the grandson of Ali ibn Abi Talib. You cannot defeat him one at a time. Surround him from every side and attack him. They began to launch their spears at him. They fired their arrows at him, surrounding him from every side. They say that Ali ibn al-Akbar with the wounds, with all the injuries and the blood spilling from the body, held on to the neck of the horse. The horse started to move in the battlefield. Ali and Al-Akbar is holding the horse so he does not fall. Now the enemy soldiers, they see this as their opportunity. They surround the horse of Ali and Al-Akbar. ورفعوا أسيافهم فقطعوه عربا عربا. Raising their swords in the sky, bringing it down on the body of Ali and Al-Akbar. They cut his body to pieces. Falling from the horse, he cries, Assalamu alaykum. Ya Abba, my father, I am falling from the horse. And Imam Hussein races to the battlefield, flying on the horse towards his son, comes towards the body of Ali and Al-Akbar. He falls on that body. They say the wounds had riddled every part. And now there is an arrow stuck in the neck. The blood is filling the throat of Ali and Al-Akbar. Imam Hussein turns to his son in the last moments, as if he is trying to say something to his father. He says in the weakest of voices, the blood is in his mouth. He says, Ya Aba, hada jaddi Rasulallah, qad saqani bi kasi al-awfa. My grandfather Rasulallah is here with me. He is giving me water from his cup. He is telling me that come back to us, Ya Hussein. Return back to us, Ya Hussein. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا آل محمد أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين إن لله وإنا إليه راجعون باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك ونقسم عليك بحق الزهراء وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها لعن الله ظالميها اللهم شافي كل مريض اللهم رد كل غريب اللهم فك كل أسير اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك يا كريم اللهم وفقنا لمراضيك وجنبنا معاصيك وثبت أقدامنا على صراطك المستقيم وخذ بأيدينا إليك يا أرحم الراحمين وفرج عنا يا الله فرجا عاجلا قريبا كلمح البصر وهو أقرب من ذلك وافرغ علينا صبرا وتوفنا مسلمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين